Our theme for today, it's creating African Center. Our theme for the Black Education Master's class for this year it's on creating African centered solutions. And our first presentation, which is on the theme of our story. So we are having two Walimus today, great brothers that will be joining us. We have Mwalimu Thandolwethu Sipuye that we are going to start with her. And then from there, we are going to have Professor Kimani Nehusi. So I will quickly just go into our first presenter's bio, just to give a bit of a quick background. Who is our brother Thandolwethu Sipuye? Brother Ras Thando Sipuye is an African-centered historian and social scientist, a grounded community activist. He's an executive member of ANC Foundation, the Afrocentric Study Group, and also the Mthatha Rastafari community. It is so great to have you, brother. It's been a while since we seen each other. I'm glad also that today we are meeting. I will open it up for you, my brother, that you just started our presentation with your presentation today. But before and after that, I will just give a bit of a background more on how we are going to do things. I don't want to waste so much time because now already we were running a little bit late. So brother Thando, I will give it up to you. Then after that, I will give some ground rules on how this session is going to go. So let me give it to you. When you after your 30 minutes presentation in your 25 minutes, I will give you a sign that you are about to finish so that we don't take long. Thank you so much, my brother.
Greetings, Mama. Greetings, Emateboho. And greetings to the entire Ebukhosini Solutions family. I greet you all, my beloved brothers and sisters. In the names of, you know, our ancestors and in the names of our God and our creator, and we call God and the creator by many names. So whatever name that you black man and black woman subscribe to, I greet you in that divine name. And I call the Almighty Jah. So I greet you in the name of His Majesty, Jah Rastafari. First and foremost, I want to really express my deepest gratitude and my most sincere thanks to Ebukhosini Solutions. I think firstly, not only for inviting me to be on this platform and to speak to my African family, but mainly for the work that you continue to do. You know, the continuous work of organizing us and organizing the Black communities and Black people in general, you see, towards, you know, the cause, which is total liberation. So your work is recognized and your work is really noticed by us wherever we are. And you have been consistent over the years. And I think one other trait of a true and genuine activist or a revolutionary, if you may use that word, is consistency in what we do and consistency in what we say, in line with what we say and what we purport to be all about. So my deepest gratitude to you, Ebukhosini Solutions, and I say big up to the family there, big up to Baba Buntu and the entire team there for the sterling work that you are doing. I also do want to, you know, extend, you know, a Black power word, you know, of love, of Black love to our beloved brother, Usandile, Sandile Msibi, the founder and the president of Arise Black Child, you know. I did not know the brother personally, but I knew him through his works and through our connections via the social media platform. as well as his connection with a number of other brothers and sisters that we work with. So I do want to invoke his name and his spirit and his presence here as we are gathered here, continuing and furthering the work that he was also committed to. Well, I've been asked to speak on the history of Black resistance in relation to the overall theme, which is creating African-centered solutions, a curriculum for power. You know, whilst I will speak, you know, in line with the overall theme and focusing on solutions, my talk here will focus mainly on the overall theme, which is the solutions that we can apply to some of the challenges that we face as the Black race, because here we are speaking for Black people and about Black people in relation to all other nations in the world. I'll look firstly at pre-colonial Black Africa, and then I do want to, you know, touch on the invasion of the white vultures. And then I will speak to some of the solutions to some of the problems that we are facing. Firstly, when we speak of history, and very often when we speak of history, people think that history is something that is very boring. It's all about all of these dates of previous and past, activities and events. But you know, history is not only about the past, but it is also about the present, and it also looks to the future. It also speaks to our future. You know, and so Dr. John Henry Clark, in particular, there's a quote of his that I like so much, where he defines history and what history is all about. And I want us to keep this in mind as we are talking about histories of Black resistance here. You know, he says that, and I quote, "History is not everything, but it is a starting point. History is a clock that people use to tell their political and cultural time of the day. It is a compass they use to find themselves on the map of human geography. It tells them where they are, but more importantly, what they must be." So this speaks to exactly what I'm saying, that history is not solely about the past. It's not only about these, what people perceive to be these boring dates about what happened in the 1800s, in the 1700s, in the 1900s, and so forth. But history is actually a compass that we can use to tell our time of day, to show us, to locate ourselves in the map of human geography, as Baba John Henry Clark would say. So whilst I will mention some particular instances of Black resistance, I will also focus on what we need to do going into the 22nd century. And I want us to keep in mind, brothers and sisters, that we are in the year 2023 now. And it is just 77 years until the year 2100. And so we are about to finish another century in 77 years time. Just keep that in mind, that in the next 77 years, a century will end. And the question we must ask ourselves is, what is it that we African people have done, and what is it that we have actually achieved through all of these years of resistance against colonial invasions and the slave masters and generally white people, to just simplify it, you know? And then I want to speak to this issue of resistance. You know, for people to resist, there ought to be a phenomena, you know, or circumstances that force them to resist. There ought to be some causal factor that propels people towards resistance, rebellion, or insurrection. In our context as African people, we speak of a history of Black resistance because we have been and still are oppressed by Arabs and Europeans, which forced us and continues to force us to resist. Resistance is about existence. It's about collective survival. It expresses and affirms our will to live, our will to be. Resistance is a process of struggle against death and oppression. So I want to now look at pre-colonial Black Africa. And I'm going to really browse through this phase because, you know, whilst we understand that maybe perhaps in the audience, there may be African people who maybe are still new or learning this information, but the history of Black civilizations has largely been spoken about. And I think I will also give maybe perhaps some books that people could go further to read. One particular book, maybe perhaps that I could suggest that people can go and look to right now is the book by Dr. Tich Ander Diop, Pre-Colonial Black Africa. And another one would be his most famous book or one of the famous books is The African Origin of Civilization, Myth or Reality. Those two books are by Dr. Tich Ander Diop. And I would suggest that people go and read them further to enhance more of their knowledge of African civilizations. But I want to say that Africa is the cradle of humanity that is well established. And so the original man and the original woman of the world, the progenitors of this world are Black people. And the Black people are the builders of great civilizations, including the development of writing, sciences, engineering, medicine, architecture, religion, and the fine arts. The very concept of a state or a nation was conceived by African people in Africa. The various kingdoms that permeated throughout the African continent were the first nation states of this world. Some African kingdoms, such as the Kingdom of Zimbabwe, the Karanga or the Kalanga Empire, the Monomotapa, the Kingdom of Mapungubwe, the Benin Kingdom, the Bakongo Empire and the Kushite Empire, the Songhai, the Kushite and the civilization of ancient Kemet are some of these nations or these states that were originated by Black people thousands of years before there was any existence of a Europe or an Asia. So Black people existed and formed these nation states thousands of years before the coming of the white men. Now, I want us to look at then the moment and the period when, because Black people, maybe perhaps I should state that, because when we say Africa is the cradle of civilization and the cradle of humanity, people then often wonder as to what exactly are these achievements that Black people really made in those times. But one of the examples of, you know, civilization originating in Africa, and mostly we tend to focus up north on countries such as, you know, Kemet, Egypt, and maybe Kush, Ethiopia, and so forth. But civilization flowed down from the south upwards into the rest of the continent. The civilization of ancient Egypt is actually the youngest of African civilizations. It is the last of our civilizations. The oldest civilizations, the oldest stone structures, the oldest pyramids, and other systems of architecture and so forth that you see in the world originate from the southern part of the continent going up. And it is in ancient Egypt when Black people then had crystallized, you know, and they had really, really mastered the art, you know, of their various civilizations, their arts, their medicine, their architecture, you know, and so forth. So it is in ancient Kemet when we had mastered it, but it does not begin in Kemet. Kemet is not the beginning, not the end. For example, the oldest stone calendar in the world is found right here in Azania, at Inzalo Yelanga in Mpumalanga, you know, and it is the oldest stone calendar, you know, and a magazine known as The Archaeologist says that, and I quote, referred to as the Stonehenge. So you know why people always have this tendency of Stonehenge, or they call it, they say that it is a standing stone circle about 30 meters in diameter in Mpumalanga, South Africa. Although uncertain, the structure is estimated to be 75,000 years old, making it the oldest man-made structure on Earth. So that is just one example of, you know, a calendar system that was developed by African people thousands of years before the existence of white people. But then also Dr. Zulu, Matabo Zulu, has written a Sisutu Dictionary of Mathematics, where he provides a theoretical and practical evidence to prove that Africans are the originators of mathematics, science, and engineering, including being the inventors of the calculator. So right now, okay, let us go into the period then now. If Black people manage to build such great civilizations, if we manage to have all of these achievements, how did we get to be where we are today? There was a series of invasions by what I call the white vultures. And it is the advent of the European Renaissance that led to the complete destruction of Black civilizations. But the Europeans did not start the invasion of African kingdoms. It was in fact the Arabs who first invaded Africa and enslaved African people. Umama Marimba and he uses a particular word, which is ma'afa, to refer to the centuries-long enslavement and murder of millions of African people by the Arabs and Europeans. Ma'afa is a Swahili term that basically refers to a great tragedy or a great destruction or a great disaster. The Arab Muslim slave trade and the so-called transatlantic slave trade, which is basically the Christian slave trade or the European Christian slave trade, we classify them as the Ma'afa, you know. These are noted, in particular, the Arab one is noted as the longest trade in human beings, and it occurred for more than 1,300 years, while taking millions of Africans away from the continent. But what I do want to also say then is that as African people were being enslaved by the Arabs, and later on, when the Europeans joined the onslaught against African people, there were a series of resistance movements that emerged. There were a series of Black people who led rebellions and insurrections in those slave plantations, both the Arab slave plantations and those European or Christian slave plantations, you know. And but also in the African continent, because there are stages of resistance that we must speak to and which must identify. The stages of resistance of the Black people are when our invasions are being, when our civilizations were being invaded, Black people resisted. A series of wars were fought, you know, by our ancestors throughout all of these kingdoms that I've mentioned and all of these empires. Our people did not go down without a fight in those parts.
The environment of the organization makes it even impossible for you to really use the resources that are offered by the Wellness Office. So yes, indeed, good people, those are the principles or tenets of critical conscious leadership. Sorry. It's about saving, you know, the lens through which, you know, organization and leaders can self-reflect. And in self-reflection, hopefully they'll...
Thank you, Asteboho. So just to mention some of those rebellions, you know, but I think, you know, I will provide this paper and it does list some of them, but I do not want to go into detail in terms of their histories because we do not really have enough time, but perhaps I will share the paper and it will be shared with everyone else. And maybe perhaps when we are engaging in the question and answer session, maybe some of you can elaborate or I can elaborate on some of these. But some of the slave rebellions that I would want to highlight, but before I go into that, like I was saying, you have got this moment of resistance against the invasion of our civilizations. Once our civilizations have been destroyed and taken by the Europeans, you then have a moment when African people are being enslaved and taken from the continent into European slave plantations. Black people resist during that moment of the, we have a number of slave rebellions. During that moment of enslavement, Black people resist. It's not as though our ancestors, you know, were casual about it and accepted to be taken into those slave ships. They resisted and fought a number of wars. And even when they reached in those foreign countries, a number of insurrections took place in resistance against the slave master. But I'm going to browse through all of these, but I want us to take note of this because the main theme of, under which I'm speaking is the history of slave resistance. I mean, the history of Black resistance. One common one that we all know and that we love so much is the revolution that took place in 1791 until 1804. Which was the Haitian Revolution, which was a successful insurrection by self-liberated slaves against the French colonial rule in the then Saint Dominique. The revolt began during this month on the 22nd of August, 1791, and it ended in 1804. It was led by the general Toussaint Louverture. This insurrection inspired hundreds of other slave rebellions in the West. And then in 1733 until 1734, you had a slave insurrection on St. John, an island called St. John. On the 23rd of November, 1733, 150 Black slaves from Akwamu in Ghana revolted against the owners and managers of the island's plantation. They were led by a man known as Brefu, a woman. And this is one other common mistake that we really make, and I do apologize for this. Because, you know, very often when we speak about insurrections, revolution, and resistance, it is largely centered around male figures. You know, men dominate the space when we talk about this. Even when you go and do your research out there, you tend to find that most of the histories that are recorded or that are told are largely those which were led, resistances that were led by men. But this one was led by Umama Brefu, an enslaved woman from Ghana. And it lasted for months into August 1734. The rebellion was one of the earliest and longest slave revolts in the Americas. The Akwamu captured the fort in Coral Bay and took control of most of the island. They intended to resume crop production under their own control. And then you had the Nat Turner Rebellion, which occurred in August 1832. Nat Turner's Rebellion occurred in August 1832. This insurrection took place at a time when slaves in Jamaica had staged one of the largest revolts in history, when radical abolition had arisen in the North and Britain was debating slave emancipation. Basically, Nat Turner went in together with other slaves and they killed and murdered a number of white slave masters. And then there is the First Maroon War, which was led by Ojo and Queen Nana, who is usually called referred to as Ukwineni. The First Maroon War was a conflict between the Maroons in Jamaica and the colonial British authorities. In 1739 until 1740, the British government in Jamaica recognized that it could not defeat the Maroons, so they came to an agreement with them. The Maroons were to remain in their five main towns and living under their own rulers. And then you've got another one, which was the Berbice slave uprising, which took place in Guyana. Berbice is a town in Guyana. It was led by two slaves named Ofi and Agara. The slave rebellion lasted from February 1763 until 1764. Ofi led the revolt of more than 2,500 Black people against the British colonies regime. After they acquired arms, the Black rebels attacked the plantation. They gained an advantage after taking the house of one of the slave masters, and they told all the whites inside that they could leave. But some of the rebels killed many as they did and took several prisoners, including the wife of one of the plantation owners. The anniversary of the Berbice slave rebellion, which is the 23rd of February, is Republic Day in Guyana. And Kofi is considered to be a national hero, commemorated in a large monument in the capital. And then lastly, you've got the Second Maroon War, which took place in 1795 until 1796, which was an 8-month conflict between the Maroons of Trelawney Town, a Maroon settlement created at the end of the First Maroon War. And it was named, this town was named after a slave master named Edward Trelawney. And then you then move from this period of these slave rebellions, Ma Afrika Mahle, because there are a number of them. If we were to list them all here, we would exhaust the time. There were a number of slave rebellions that took place, even including some here on the African continent. You know, in the African continent, you had a number of resistance movements that we had here. And I want to just speak to some of those before I move on. Okay, yeah. Well, these are some of the anti-colonial wars of resistance, you know, because I do consider the period of colonialism to be a continuation of the enslavement period, because under colonialism, as Black people, we were regarded as nothing but slaves. But also, the funny thing here is that even under so-called democracy, under so-called independence, you know, after Africa went through that phase of anti-colonial wars, we still continue to be slaves in our own forefatherland. Throughout the African continent, Black people are still slaves. So the anti-colonial wars of resistance, the first phase of African resistance to colonial rule begins from about 1880 up until, you know, they say up until around 1960s, the late 1960s. One of the wars which I want to mention and highlight here is the first Chimurenga War, which was fought in Zimbabwe. In Zimbabwe, the Chimurenga War is today celebrated as the first war of independence. It is also known as the Second Matebele War. This was a war of resistance that lasted from 1896 until 1897, with the Ndebele and Shona people fighting hand in hand and revolting against Cecil John Rhodes' British South African Company. And then you've got in Malawi, the Chilembwe Uprising of 1915, which was a rebellion against British colonial rule. And it took place in January 1915. The revolt was led by John Chilembwe, and it broke out in the evening of the 23rd of January 1915, when they attacked the headquarters of the A.L. Bruce Plantation at Magomero and killed about three white people. After a failed attack by government troops on Mbombwe, which was the hometown of John Chilembwe, The rebels attacked a Christian mission at Nguludi and burned it down. And then you've got the Volta Bani War, which also took place from 1915 until 1917. It was an anti-colonial rebellion which took place in French West Africa in the areas of Burkina Faso and Mali between 1915 and 1917. It was a war between an indigenous African force drawn from a heterogeneous coalition of local people. So a number of local peoples came together to resist against the French army. At its height in 1916, the rebels were as strong as about 20,000 men, and they fought on several fronts, and they defeated and they crushed the French army. This is in 1917. The Mozambican War of Resistance was an armed conflict between the guerrilla forces of Mozambique Liberation Front, known as Frelimo, and the colonialists of Portugal, the Portuguese army. The war officially started on September 25th, 1964, and it ended with a ceasefire on September 8, 1974, resulting in a negotiated independence of Mozambique in 1975. And then lastly, and I've not mentioned some of these, but of 1967 until 1979, it was known as the Rhodesian Bush War or the Zimbabwe Liberation War. And it refers to the guerrilla war, which led to the end of white minority rule in the then Rhodesia. And the physical manifestation of the war was a conflict between the predominantly white minority government headed by Ian Smith and the black nationalist movements of ZANU and ZAPU, which were respectively led by Gabriel Mugabe and Joshua Nkomo. So I think these are some of, I'm highlighting these because these are some of, you know, the particular moments or histories of resistance that Black people were engaged in warfare and in resistance against the invading European invaders. But now I also just want to say, maybe perhaps there are some books that people can go and read just so that they can further their knowledge and expand their knowledge on some of these histories, but on these histories of Black civilization, on the histories of our invasions, but also on the history of our resistance to these invasions. You know, some of these books, I will just read through them. It's one of them is When We Ruled by Robin Walker. You can go and check out The Destruction of Black Civilizations, The Great Issues of a Race from 4,500 BC to 2000 AD by Chancellor Williams. The Blueprint for Black Power by Amos Wilson, which is one of my most favorite books because it speaks to exactly some of the work that is being done by Ebukhosini Solutions. It speaks exactly to how do we build power? How do we build power? And I think Baba Amos Wilson has given us really a black print there, more than a blueprint. African Origins of Civilization, Myth or Reality, I've already mentioned that one. But also to know more about the Arab, invasions and the Arab enslavement of Black people, there is the book Reflections of Arab-led Slavery of Africans. It's called Reflections of Arab-led Slavery of Africans, and it's edited by Professor Kwesi Bra. And then there's Yoruku by Mama Marimba Ani. But lastly, I would urge anyone to also read the book by our very own Bantu Biko, I Write What I Like, because I think Biko also speaks a lot to some of the histories of Black resistance, but also Biko gave us a theory or tools of resistance in giving us Black consciousness, in advancing the ideas he was advancing in Black consciousness. So in concluding, I want to say that our ancestors resisted. I want to emphasize that our ancestors resisted during the colonial era, during the enslavement era, during the invasion of our civilizations. Our ancestors resisted. But knowing all of this history of these dates and what our ancestors they did and all of that is not enough. It does not really help us much. Yes, it's good to know that our ancestors achieved this, they did this, they crushed and defeated the Europeans, they crushed and defeated for boosting our confidence and all of that. To know that actually white people are not invincible, they can be destroyed, they can be crushed in battle. But our ancestors resisted because they wanted to preserve their civilizations. They wanted to preserve their livelihood, their social, cultural, political, and economic systems. But we find ourselves today that we are still in a continuous state of resistance because we have not really regained our civilizations. We have not regained any of our social, cultural, and political and economic systems. We have not built any notable institutions today that can effectively challenge the global white power structure. We are still a race of people dependent on the oppressor and the enslaver and the colonialist for survival and our daily existence. In fact, every fiber of our existence is tied up to either the European or the Arab, and now the Asians as well. So we do not own the means of production in any part of the African continent or the Black world. We do not, simply do not own the means of production anywhere. Throughout Africa, all of the mineral wealth is still owned and monopolized by Europeans and Arabs. Throughout the continent, we continue to worship the gods of our oppressors and we eat the food of our enemies and we let them dress us, educate us, and they condition us socially. And a nation or a people that cannot produce its own underwear and toilet paper is a nation of slaves. And so the solutions to the problem, one, we must use some of Africa's civilizations that we always invoke and speak to as some form of a template or a prototype of the kind of society or the kind of state that we want to build going into the 22nd century. We must stop working in silos and unite our efforts. We must complement each other and not compete with each other. And this is what Ebu Kosini Solutions is actually doing, bringing all of these people who are coming from these different organizations and structures, these different backgrounds, bringing us here together in this organized fashion so that we bring our efforts together. But one of the most important things that I think we need to do is the one that Dr. Amos Wilson gave us the blueprint for. We must build power because it doesn't matter what we achieve or what we do or how much we can talk and all of that. If we do not have the power to manifest the ideas that we articulate, to build institutions to house all of these ideas, these beautiful ideas, then the enemy at any time can come and destroy whatever we have built as Black people. So we need to build power. And the power that we must build, it must be centered around three particular areas, around educational institutions, build institutions, universities, think tanks, schools, and these schools must not become just mediocre things that we are doing on the side. We need institutions that will compete at the world stage, institutions that we will build from the ground up. But we can never be able to achieve building of these institutions without building our economic power as well, which is one of the areas where I think we need to focus on building power. We need to build, as Dr. Amos Wilson says, we must build an economic system, you see, more than just only forming businesses and so forth. And he further says that an economic system is not only money. We're not saying let's form stock fells and put money in together and then say that we are building our own economy as Black people. But we must build whole collective systems that speak to human relations, how we relate to Black people, how we relate to one another, and how we relate to the world. But also we need to understand that economic activities are fundamental in any form of study, you know? And economic activities, in fact, they demand more initiative and commitment and hard work and less talk than the politics and the religion. I mean, we can speak politics, shout Black power all day. We can, speak to pray all day, invoke the names of our ancestors, pour libations all day. But as long as we do not organize around building a proper economic system that speaks to solving the challenges that we are faced with as Black people, we will not achieve what we want to do. We are currently a race of dependent job seekers. For example, I'm sure we all know and we are aware that, there is a rise in the so-called unemployment rate in this country. And most of those people who are said to be unemployed are Black people. But I do think that there is a space there that we miss as organizers, as activists, as people who claim to be revolutionaries in this time, to say that how can Black people be unemployed when there is so much work that needs to be done in the Black communities, in the townships, in the rural areas? This speaks again to the fact that we need economics, because there is no way that we can build industries, build factories where our people can be employed and be engaged in activities for their own survival, to restore their human dignity. Because for one to work or for one to be unemployed and stay at home and be whatever we have been made to be by the system, it's an inhuman position to find yourself in. And so it is our responsibility, to build an economic system that will really speak to these challenges and these issues. Lastly, we must also build our cultural as well as what I want to call, let me just leave it there, our cultural institutions. And this will include what I, political institutions, our military institutions and so forth, But also we must have a plan to counter, the European propaganda, We must develop our own media channels, such as, for example, we are on a platform right now, it's called Zoom and so forth, but it's not our platform. YouTube is not our platform. Facebook is not our platform, but we use these for now because this is what we have. But surely and most certainly, we have Black people with enough expertise in our race who can be able to create some of these apps for us and all of these social and various media platforms so that we can use our own platforms undeterred and unheard and not controlled by the people who own and control all of these platforms and pools that we currently use, because we have not yet reached that stage when we are able to build our own. And like I've said, in order for us to build anything, I want to overemphasize the point of economics, because I think we have managed as Black people to organize around many other areas. We have managed to organize around religion, we have managed to organize around politics. We have many political institutions and so forth. But one area where I still see that we have not really mastered the art of organizing is this area of economics, because the economics is what will enable us to really manifest everything that we desire, all of these ideas that we want, all of these institutions. Ebukosini Solutions needs to have a building there, you know, where we can go to and hold these classes at that university that has been established by Ebukosini Solutions, working with others. But in closing, I want to say there are a number of other institutions then that are working in this area, like Ebukosini Solutions, you know, the work of Ubaba Buntu and Umama Buntu. Then you've got the Great Empire of Kemet, where Mkhulu Ntsingiza is also doing a great work there. You've got Umuchuloko, you know, Ubaba Uzama, Ubaba Umamathabo Zulu, you see, who established the Independent University of Madisebo. And then you've got our very own Usompisi Uveli Mbele and the work they are doing at the Black Power Front and the Mutapa Dialogues. Umama Gqothiwe, Unwabisa Gqothiwe, who is the founder of Buyelembo Village. You've got Mama Nokzola Mdende of the Itamagu Institute. And then Mama Ya Asantewa of the Institute of Africology. All of these institutions are doing great work. And what I think we need to do is to accelerate the effort to unite our effort, you know, to unite our efforts, accelerate the work, but also continue to support one another as we are doing right here, right now. You know, because at the moment, some okay. of these institutions are working in silos.
My brother, thank you. We are going to the end now. You have used all your time now. But thank you so much. Thank you so much for that. Yes. You're good.
No, thank you. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mama. Thank you, Mama.
Thank you, brother. Thank you so much. It's not easy when we talk about our thing, our story, our experiences that we can even be short. Sometimes we just need the whole time because we are coming with a lot that we are carrying inside of ourselves. I will just go now into the second part of our session today. But before that, I will just give this outline that after I have introduced Professor Nehusi Ikimani Nehusi, who will take us through the history of Pan-Africanism, we will take questions and answers from there. When you ask the question, you open up your camera, you introduce your name and from which, from where are you, you are logging in from, so that at least we know where people are situated. Then you ask your question. And I will ask that when you ask your question, please, please, can it not be another presentation? Just go straight into the question and outline which presenter, which mualimu you want to answer that question. I will now take give us a bit of a background or a bio of Professor Kimani Nehusi, from originally from Guyana. Mwalimu Kimani S. Nehusi is currently teaches in the Department of Africology at the Temple University. His scholarship is distinguished by strong interest in the Afrocentric study of the African world from ancient times to the future, as well as of the Caribbean and Guyana. I'm so glad that we today we are having Mwalimu Kimani to be with us here. Also just thinking of this amazing scholarly work that he's doing. And I think like you have said right now, my brother Tandoletu, about the importance of us reading. We must read our writers. What are they saying about us, so that we should be able to be clear and understanding if we come up with solution, who are we drawing and understanding from? So I will open now to Mwalimu Kimani Nehusi to be with us. The stage is yours, my brother. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sister Tibogo Buntu. Greetings. Once again, good to see you. Are you hearing me?
Loud and clear,
yes,
brother.
Yes.
Loud and clear.
Yes, yes, we can hear you.
Thank you.
Yes, we hear you. We hear you.
Thank you. I give thanks to Ibukuni Solutions for organizing this occasion where we could speak with each other. I give thanks to the other presenters, our brother, Ras Tando, and I give thanks to all our listeners. I want to share screen so that we could see some of the things that I wanted to flash as we proceed. I hope you're seeing my screen. Are you seeing my screen?
Yes, we're seeing it, Prof. Yes, we're seeing it.
Yes, we can.
Good, thanks. Now, I am supposed to talk on the history of Pan-Africanism. And I want to suggest that what I'm going to do is a history of Pan-Africanism, seeing that there could be many different histories. And I hope that by the time we're finished, you would understand what I mean. So let's get into it. We meet in very, very specific contexts today. And one of the elements in our context is xenophobia and its meaning in Azania. And I think it's particularly important for us to look at that question, perhaps very briefly, because xenophobia in Azania or in any other part of Africa aimed against other African people is really rooted in a misunderstanding of ourselves, of who we are. You're going to see as we proceed that we were Africans long before we were Zulu or South Africans or Nigerians or Igbo or anything else. And that further, each one of those divisions is usually a different way of being African, but it is not inferior or superior to being any other kind, if I might put it that way, of African. And these are things we need to understand. Of course, I mentioned countries, South Africa, Nigeria, and so on. And we need to be aware that those are the constructions of our oppressors, European plantations. And therefore, when we want to privilege our membership of a particular European plantation, whether it's called Nigeria or South Africa, above being an African, we're really defining ourselves according to our enemies. And, you know, we could debate that a lot. And I think it's very important that we do so. But before I leave that topic or that part of our topic, let me just say this, that when we say that such and such a person is not from a plantation called South Africa, and that somebody else is, what we're really doing is confusing identity with nationality. Your identity or our identity is inalienable. The moment we give up our identity or we allow other people to tamper with it, we're in a serious, serious struggle, the most fundamental kind of struggle that results in the condition that Ras Tando mentioned just now. On the other hand, nationality is easy to change. Once you have a passport to a country, well, you're a national of that country. It's a completely different thing. And I think it's important that we understand this. What's the other aspect of the current context that I wish to mention? It's the rise of the global majority. Briefly, Western Europeans went around the world from 6 centuries ago, violently imposing themselves upon other peoples. We who are African understand that it's an aspect of the Ma'afa, but Arabs 1500 years before Europeans had swooped down upon Africa and did much the same. But Europeans are the latest wave of oppressors, if you might put it that way. And they have oppressed some Arab people also. So what's happening now is that more and more people, in a process that began when Europeans began to do this, are throwing off European oppression. Excuse me. They're becoming more aware of what has happened to them and what is happening to them. And they're becoming more determined to oppose the attempts by Western Europeans to grab more of their riches, their labor, and so on. So after a long process of European empires, the rule of European empires, the Dutch, the Portuguese, Spanish, French, English, we have the American Empire. It's not as obvious to some people as the other empires were, but we live in a unipolar world, which is imposed upon us by an American empire. And people are beginning to confront that American empire. The war in the Ukraine right now is an aspect of that, because the leaders of the Western world want to attack Russia and attack China and subject them to their own rule and the looting of their resources. So Russia is resisting, so are other countries. And it's very important for us to understand this aspect of the context in which we live today. And I think that the major question that is asked by this context, and it's a major question that has always been asked of our African people: how and where is Africa located in this upcoming new world order? I'm saying it's a multi-civilizational world order, because you have Chinese civilization, Russian civilization. What happened with Africa? That must be part of our response. Like Brother Tando was saying, build our own civilization. In my instance, I would say, rebuild our civilization. And I hope you recognize the difference. And again, this new world order that is upcoming, the changes, the tectonic shifts in the world, is asking the question of African people: who are you? And this is very important. This is the most fundamental question to be asked of any human being. Who are you? And if we cannot answer that question properly, it shows that we're in the deepest trouble. And I again stress Rastando's description of our condition that shows that in practical terms, we are not answering that question properly. We can't define ourselves, and because we don't define ourselves according to our own history, culture, and interests, we don't know what our interests are. And because we don't know what our interests are, we cannot defend and advance those interests. So many of us would prefer to be imitators of our oppressors rather than the discoverers and the continuation of our own traditions. So for me, Pan-Africanism is basically African unity. I don't want to go into the weeds about this. Let's agree, Pan-Africanism is African unity. It's African people coming together. And in the history of Pan-Africanism, we have tended to stress the political and the economic aspects of it. We have had many organizations and processes in which people have tried to unite. Then more recently, we started talking about economic initiatives. But our historical and especially our cultural unity has largely eluded many of us. And I'm positing this to us, that the important, the most critical areas of African unity and therefore of Pan-Africanism lie in our historical and cultural unity. And further, we have a groundwork, we have a network of cultural and historical ties that we should recognize, revive, invigorate, if we wish to achieve African unity and therefore Pan-Africanism. And let's be clear about this. Pan-Africanism is a condition of African liberation. So what are the origins of Pan-Africanism? Now, I'm absolutely certain that you know and or could find the text that talk about the Pan-African conferences and Pan-African congresses. You know, beginning in 1900 with Henry Sylvester Williams and so on and so forth, some organized by W.E.B. Du Bois. And then, of course, the famous Manchester Congress of 1945. That's famous because that's where the independence of Africa was planned. So it was strategic in a way. It offers quite a lot of lessons for us. But what I want to emphasize here is that we were talking mostly about political unity in those origins of Pan-Africanism. We were talking about a movement that essentially began in the diaspora. And while I don't want to rubbish previous efforts, and I certainly don't want to rubbish the contribution of Africans in the diaspora, you're going to see that my argument is that we had previously been practicing Pan-Africanism. Brother Tando mentioned some of it, and I'm going to return to that in a moment. But for now, let me just say that the new ideas of Pan-Africanism, and I put new in inverted commas because these are not really new. This, what I want to talk about is an emphasis on an Afrocentric vision. We cannot be serving our interests if we don't have an Afrocentric vision of whatsoever we are doing, of ourselves and of our reality. And right now, Afrocentrism is a doctrine, a way of studying Africa that locates our vision of ourselves, that is our identity, and the study of ourselves within our entire history and culture of the African world. We cannot properly study ourselves and understand ourselves if we do not center ourselves in our entire history and culture. Let us be clear that one of the things that our oppressors did was to impose their conceptions of reality upon us. We could talk at length about the destruction of African identity and the struggle for African identity. I don't propose to go into that, but we could ask questions if necessary to illustrate what I'm talking about here. And I wish to talk about Molefe Kete-Esanti, who is a major architect of Afrocentrism. So it's important that we look at the world from our own points of view. If we don't, we will not be able to understand or understand fully what it is we're talking about, even about ourselves. The other element I want to mention briefly here is Afrofuturism, because this is a way of constructing the African future in the present. And I think it's very important that we recognize that we need to begin to strategically plan our future right now. Even if it's just writing what you might call dream books. And here I must mention briefly that Europeans were writing about first men on the moon, around the world in 80 days, going traveling on the sea before they had the technical capacity to do that. But it's because they dreamt about it, wrote about these things, they set themselves the challenge of doing it. You know the rest of that story. We've got to set ourselves challenges so that we and other succeeding generations could work towards commonly agreed goals. It doesn't matter how far off those goals might seem. The fact is that every road, every journey begins with the first steps. And if you want to do something properly, one of the first steps is visualizing what it is you want to do. Here's something that the great Shekhanta Diop, who needs no introduction, has said. The bonds that we are in the process of re-establishing go back even before the birth of Egyptian civilization. This is in tandem with what Brad Stando told us. It is that historic bond that unites us and makes the difference. The fact of having lived in the same cradle shaped and transformed us. Instinctively, we have the same sensory response to the same reality. For example, we have similar rhythm and a similar respect for nature. We have the same sense of unity, and this potential for unity is a consequence of a shared history. Now, we could point out so many things. You know, you Africans from all over the world start a piece of music, and before the first bar is finished, we're in the beat. We dance to the same beat, the same drums. Why is that? There are so many things about us, and I'm going to mention some more that are the same, even with variations, that this is something, a strength that we need to harness. If we don't, we are wasting some of the most precious gifts of our ancestors. We lived in the same cradle. We are shaped and transformed by our experiences in that cradle. We're going to come back to that. Here's Patrice Lumumba telling us almost the same thing. Despite the boundaries that separate us, despite our ethnic differences, we have the same conscience, the same soul plunged day and night in anguish, the same wish to make the African continent a free and happy continent that has rid itself of unrest and of fear and of any sort of colonialist domination. What do they mean? Let us see. In attempting to understand who we are, in attempting to look at what Pan-Africanism is, where it comes from, let us place the African self squarely in the picture. Because if we don't relate to our people, then we're not doing anything. The dominant idea of the African self usually begins with a tradition that is poorly understood. It does not begin at the beginnings of Africa. It also usually excludes the greater part of the social history of Africa, and it is therefore dysfunctional. Like I said before, Africans were Africans long before we were Yoruba or Zulu or Nigerian, Ghanaian, and so on and so forth. So who are we really? Where do we come from? Again, Rastando has given us some of that information, and it's at the risk of repeating some of what he said, which perhaps I must do, that I'm going to go to that in a minute. But first, let me emphasize this. I think all of us have agreed, directly or indirectly, that the current Africa is dysfunctional for African people, the current state of Africa, as Rastando has pointed out. So let us agree also or recognize that if we wish to change our reality, we must first of all be determined to change ourselves. What Arabs and Europeans have done is tamper with the identity of African people, as I mentioned before. We still have their names. We still go to their churches and mosques and so on. We still live in states that have been organized to suit them and not us. And I'm going to come to that in a moment. The major consequence of Arab and European misadventures in Africa has been the distortion of the African personality. We still have individualism, greed, and a number of other aspects of backwardness that power our present. Xenophobia is another one I mentioned before that's very relevant here. So we have to build a new Africa. But that new Africa, a new African world, because it must extend to the diaspora, is not possible without the new African at home and abroad. You cannot build a new Africa without a new African. And the new African will not materialize from nowhere, unaided by African socialization, including African education. So in our attempts to understand the need for Pan-Africanism, here is one of the things we need to do. Look at the African personality and understand that our response to the Ma'afa has got to rebuild the African personality and understand it in a way that recognizes that that African personality is a personality of all African people. And this is not magic. It's not anything difficult, because we have been essentially the same people all our lives. And I'm going to show you some of it. This is where we come to the ancient roots of Pan-Africanism, roots that we usually do not articulate when we talk about Pan-Africanism. And this is why I didn't mention, I didn't spend a lot of time talking about, you know, Pan-African Congress here, Pan-African Conference there, and so on, and Pan-African organizations and so on, that we tend to know a whole lot of. So we're the people of the same origin. Humanity was born in Africa in black skin and fizzy hair under a tropical sky. Nobody does that today. The first human beings were Africans. All Africans originated from that first human being. We share the same culture. Now, because of the tremendous measures of space and time that has been occupied and is still occupied by the African experience, it is logical that variations have occurred. But our enemies have taught us to focus on those variations. And we multiply the significance of those variations. And so we balkanize ourselves and pit us against each other. And I'm very conscious of the war between Zulu and Xhosa in Azania in the 90s. People were basically the same people, were fighting against each other and killing each other, because our perception of ourselves has been tampered with by our enemies. So we no longer see brothers and sisters as family, as brothers and sisters. We see them as the enemy who gains. These are practical experiences that we need to learn from. Again, we have the same culture. It shouldn't matter if you name your child 3 days after the physical birth, and another group over there does the same thing 4 days after. We're doing the same thing. There are variations, But how significant really are those variations? We have to rediscover ourselves and the ties that bind us, that run through our entire experience and bind us. We have the same history. Sometimes the details may differ, but we have the same history. I mean, the Ma'afa, what's bigger than the Ma'afa in our existence, tragically? But it's the same story. Arabs and Europeans forced themselves onto our lands, stole our lands, stole our people, raped and plundered, and established systems that continue that domination, their domination of us. Like I said, the details may differ, but it's the same thing. The struggle for land in Kenya or Zimbabwe is the same as in Tanzania. The details may differ, same thing. You go to any part of the Caribbean, African people struggling for land, same thing. Why? Our history is basically the same. We also have the same economic aims. Show me a place in the world where Africans are economically emancipated. Again, we refer to Ras Tando's presentation, where we produce what we consume and consume what we produce. Basically, these are not his words, but you know, in a nutshell, this is what he was saying. And therefore, because we are the same people, the same origin, the same culture, the same history, and have the same economic aims, we also have the same political aims, because our politics must be in service of our real interests. Our interests in the economy, our interest in restoring our understanding of ourselves, and so on. So part of our response to our condition, part of the solution to the question of Pan-Africanism has got to be strategic political organization. I'm going to come back to that, strategic political organization. And I've said this before, but again, let's do a Sankofa moment, looking back to move forward and recognize that the independence movement in Africa, especially the 1945 Congress and after, was really a struggle. And this includes the armed struggle in Southern Africa. It was a struggle mostly, though not only, for political and physical territory. We weren't struggling for cultural sovereignty. We weren't struggling for control of the African mind. We weren't struggling for retaking the African personality, whether it's individual or collective personality of African people. And I'm saying that this is a key area of our struggle, of Pan-Africanism. And a lot of what my work has been in the last two or three decades came out of a certain moment within Pan-Africanism. This is the late 1900s, early 2000s, when there was a debate between those of us who were called cultural nationalists. That wasn't a nice term at that point in time, versus the people who I would call political unionists, who were saying, we have to unite the continent. And they weren't considering very much the basis of this Pan-African unity they were talking about. So mostly it was political unity. My thesis is that political unity is necessary, but we also have to have economic, social, cultural, and other kinds of struggles for emancipation simultaneously with our struggle for political unity. Again, this addresses our African cultural and historical concept of holism, of an integrated struggle. So let's look at some examples of the ancient roots of Pan-Africanism. And again, we're not going to go deeply into this, you know them. Kemet. And again, let me emphasize, some people say Kemet is the beginning of Africa. It's not. The significance of Kemet is that it is the first African state that we know much about. We have a whole lot of details. And when any African examines Kemet, What we're really looking at is an ancient version of ourselves. So Kemet is significant in that way. And when you look at the person and the collective family or clan, village, community in Kemet, you see a microcosm, you see an early version of what prevails today when Africa remains itself. I put person in brackets because nobody lived by himself or herself in Kemet. It's the same thing. You're a collective being. You become a person because you're in a relation or in relationships with other people. So you have the family and the clan. And many families and clans come together to make a village or some kind of a community. Those communities come together to make a sipat. That's the word in ancient Egyptian. Today we call it a state. And those states come together to make a nation state. Kemet was the first confederated state in the world. The United States is a model after Kemet. Let that sink in. Now, what were the sinews of this unity? Well, everyone had a name, every community had a name. All of these different aspects, these bricks in the organizational wall that we eventually call the nation state, the subsets, the family, clan, village, community, the state and the nation state had a name, which was something important. We know the importance of African names, of individuals and of larger constructs than the individual. And there's a whole thesis to be written about African names throughout the continent. Then we had a divinity, let's say God for now. We had a totem. This was a representative animal, being, or thing that everybody recognized as belonging to him or her. Usually a particular aspect, a strength of the totem was what was celebrated. For example, the lion. It wasn't because people thought they resembled a lion. It's because they admired the strength and the persistence of a lion and so on and so forth. And then there were also rituals. I mentioned libation. I've written a book on libation. And all over the African world, people do certain rituals at certain points in time. So libation is one of them. They're sensing. But also people do initiation rituals. People do certain rituals in naming ceremonies and so on and so forth. And I am saying that if we go around Africa, we're going to see that each one of these rituals tend to be the same throughout the country, our people's existence. So I know a lot about libation, same thing. There might be variations. I know something about namings and names, same thing. There are names in Azania today that are identical to names in ancient Egypt. How is that? We could talk about that. Marriage, eldership, transition into the ancestral world, all of these rituals and occasions that mark the circle of life in African life are essentially the same. My argument is we've got to retake these things about ourselves, these daily celebrations of ourselves. We've got to live a life that is based on these, construct and reconstruct a life that's alternative to the failed lives, models imposed upon us by our oppressors. Become ourselves again. This is Pan-Africanism. It doesn't matter that there are slight variations. Let us recognize the unity in our heritage and begin to live that heritage again. Not every Saturday, not every African Liberation Day, but every moment in our lives. African traditional values are the same. This is something that struck me. And if we go to our earliest communities, one of them is the Mbuthi, but this is not the only one. There's something called Ikimi and Akami. One is unity, it's goodness, if we might put it in a nutshell, order, unity, and all the other things. The other one, the opposite, is Akami. In ancient Egypt, it's Ma'at, which means order, righteousness, virtue, all kinds of things. The opposite of Ma'at is Isfet, chaos. In Southern Africa, well, I'm home here, Ubuntu. And you will know the ramifications of Ubuntu. You would know Harambe, Ujima, and so on. Now, I'm saying that all of these things are basically the same things. African people abhor individualism, not individuality, but individualism. The projection of individual interests above those of the community interests. This is basic throughout Africa. We've got different names for it, but it's the same thing we're talking about. We have to rediscover this similarity that runs through our people's existence and begin to live it again. Call it okay, by Prof, our own names.
Prof, we are having 5 minutes of your time now.
Okay, I'll be done in a moment.
All right, thank you.
All of this boils down to an attempt to live Ma'at, Ubuntu, and so on. That means character. How does an individual or a group of people live the social values of our people? And again, that comes down to the ethics, what we call manners. In every society, you don't have the time to go through that, but in every African society, there is a question of good manners, the ethics that are based in our social values. If you talk about Iwa Pele in Yoruba, for example. So, you know, when you look at the succeeding states, empires, Toh, Kemet, you see the same model. Ghana, Mali, Songhai, and so on, the Zulu Empire. You know, there's a time when somebody asked Shaka Zulu, well, why are you including those people over there? And he said, well, they're Zulus. They may not have been Zulu at the start of the war, but they're Zulus now because they participated. We need to examine those examples, those moments, and find out what they mean for us. And something that we usually do not recognize is African communities in Plantation America. Now, Europeans gathered Africans from all over the African continent, predominantly West Africa. And one of the things they did was to make certain that they didn't put people from the same language, ethnic groups, communities together on those plantations. But what happened? In the click of a finger, Africans on those plantations, as well as those who ran away and established independent African communities, established communities. Functioning communities. Why did this happen? If Africans were as different from each other as we've been taught to believe that we are different from each other, that kind of speedy establishment of functioning, fully integrated communities containing Africans from different parts of the African world could not have been possible. The means of integration were carried in our souls. And we must rediscover that understanding of ourselves. It arises in part from this kind of example. So that's again coming back to the same solution. And in a way, I want to end with a return to this historical moment we're in. And I want to address very briefly the question of Pan-Africanism and the coups in the Sahel that has got the Western world rattled. And here's a quotation is from Ibrahim Traoré, who is the president of Burkina Faso. And this was said less than a couple of weeks ago. An enslaved person who does not rebel does not deserve pity. The African Union must stop condemning Africans who decide to fight against their own puppet regimes of the West. It is up to African people to choose the weapons of our liberation. Nobody else could choose that for us. And whether we choose to fight with guns directed by our minds that are in order, whether we choose to fight for strategic political action. I'm saying that Pan-Africanism is a fight for African liberation on the basis of African unity. We've got to begin to do all of those things we mentioned before, but we also have to intervene in whatever state we live to do strategic actions that we might call political action. For example, why not get the residents in a particular block to say, we want to rename the street. We don't want the street to be named Gandhi Street or some offensive name, offensive to our African people. So I hope that I've provided enough material to tease out a whole lot of questions and debate. I'm conscious of the fact that I've stepped over time for a little bit, and therefore I want to end this part of the presentation at this moment. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Prof. Thank you so much. Wow. Thank you, Prof. Thank you for those insights. Just as a quick reminder that the Black Education Masterclass, it's really meant to give the foundational understanding for those who are starting or those who are questioning or those who wants to understand more about African understanding, African knowledge. So we are having all these presenters to always give us those background so that if people can be empowered if, when they have to make the decision, at least they have more information. And also to share a lot of literature that people should go and read for themselves. And that one, I want to emphasize it. People must start to read more and more so that they can understand some other issues that they might not have a grasp of them. And when you don't read, you won't be even understand what you're supposed to be doing. I'll just go into some other few things that I just get from you, Prof, and also from you, Brother Tando, that we cannot build power when we don't have the content and the context of our history. So it is very important that always we have that content and context. Also, what Prof has just said, that you can be, we can build new Africa without a new African. I think that is very important. Because when we are not bringing in all young people that can be the one that are bringing new Africa that we want, we cannot be able to do that when we are not also supporting them by also creating platform like this. So I'm going to open up now for questions. Like I said, that with questions, you open your mic, you introduce yourself and where you are logging in from, and you ask a short question. And I will emphasize it, please just ask a question, not a presentation. I think we have already got enough presentation. We just want questions. And when you ask a question, be clear, who are you asking this question to? Which mualimu are you asking this question to so that they can be able to know how to answer? And if you ask them both, you can just say that you're asking this question for both of them to answer. So we are open now for questions and answers to everyone. If you have a question, please make sure that we can be able to see. We see you. Any question? Any comment? Any clarity? Oh, people are okay. Any solution?
Greetings, everybody.
Thank you, Oxmabato. Go ahead.
Finally load shedding, so excuse my video. So for me, it's just basically a comment around the one thing we seem to be failing at organizing, which was spoken about by the first presenter, which is the economy. And I think we all understand Maslow's hierarchy of needs, or anybody's hierarchy of needs. shelter, security, the list goes on. I think we can all appreciate that it can be very challenging for young people to make time or to have the interest to understand who they are when they do not have the basic means to survive. Coupled with that is the fact that the Westerners or the colonizers have ensured that they make their way of doing things, so they've packaged it in a way that looks very attractive to many young Black people. And so as people who are working on helping to liberate our people, in what ways can we reimagine the new African, looking at how much societies have evolved, looking at how things are different? And I think for me, at least, I've come to understand that even from a spiritual perspective, spirit evolves. So in what ways can we bring the awareness and reintroduce the culture, the knowledge, in ways that interest and that are appealing to the young African? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mabato. I will take two more questions, and then Mwalimu Nehusi and Mwalimu Ntando, you'll just take notes, and then when you respond, you'll just respond to all of them. I have noted you, Brother Nzanua, and then after that, it will be Brother Robiko. Like I was just saying to everyone, and then from there, we have Kafezile. Please, can we make sure that we don't make too long questions? Just ask a short question quickly so that our presenters can be able to capture them well. We'll start with you, my brother Nzanua. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Mama T, and greetings to the whole family. So my question, it's one question, but I think I can just make it so that the two Mwalimus can just share their wisdom. Basically, I was very enlightened, you know, with everything they said, especially when it comes to the solution. So this is a question that's going to be to Mwalimu Ras Tando. I just wanted to know, he spoke about some solutions, because really we're trying to be solution oriented. So apart from the schools and teaching, you know, Black people, I was trying to find out that what about Black people deciding to do a diagnostic? Because my question is basically, if I can try to make it short, is that what does Mwalimu think of the fact that Black people, we have never really sat down and really look at our history in the point of what's really happened to our people so that they can be defeated? You know, we are always, it looks like we kind of lack that accountability whenever we approach the situation of this is our history, this is what happened to us. But what about what really went wrong? You know, like at this point, so and so went wrong. So my question specifically would be, if Mwalimu can tell us, according to, you know, his studies, and if there's one specific thing, you know, one specific point that he can identify that really leads to our failure, so that we can learn from it and we cannot repeat the same mistake in the future. And I think if I can just add something quick, that's going to be for the second lecture that we have.
I'm sorry, my brother. I'm sorry, we have a couple of people, so I just take one question. That is why I want people to be very short and straight. So I'm going to cut you on that story about that and go to the next one. Brother Roviko, I saw your hand, and then from there, it's Kafezile, then Tato. Please be short, or I will just cut you off if you are not going to go straight into your question. Thank you.
Sorry, can you help us again with the logic or the sequence of who must start first on those whom you have noted?
You can. What do you mean the sequence? You mean who do you want to?
In the order of noting.
It's you now. After that, it's Roviko.
Oh, so it's me now.
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay. Mine perhaps is short. I'm not sure if I'll be able to make my point across in a comprehensive fashion. Okay, let me start. I think by 1900, by year 1900, we had all of what was pre-colonial Africa already destroyed or discarded. We had already a little trace of what was pre-colonial Africa. And now, how do we then restore all that? Are we in the business of restoring the pre-colonial Africa, which is quite a difficult route to take? Or are we to craft, design, create a new Africa, yet uniquely Africa? I'm not sure if I've made my point across. Then that's my question. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I hope that the Mualimu has managed to
capture
it
well.
Yeah, to capture it well. Yeah. Brother Roviko.
Thank you.
Brother Roviko, are you there? Whilst Brother Roviko is still trying to connect him, can we just take the last one from Brother Tato, and then from there we are going to the Mualimus. Thank you.
My name is Roviko Obet Maremkondo. My question is to the second Mualimu. On the presentation of Asian roots of Pan-Africanism, one people, one aim, and one destiny. There is same origin, culture, history, and economic aim, and political aim. Kindly, I didn't see the religion or the spirituality in the list. Can Mualimu, the second Mualimu, explain why those two aspects they were left out? Because as Africans, we seem to be challenged in the families and in society by the spirituality aspect and the religion aspect. Nda, Roviko.
Thank you. Tato, and then from there, it's to you, Mualimus. Tato, I saw your hand. Okay, since Tato is not coming in, can we get a response from both you, Mualimus? You'll just maybe Rust, Tando, you can start, and then from there it will be Mualimu Nehusi. Rust, Tando, you can respond. Thank you.
All right. Am I audible? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. Firstly, I've seen that on the chat box, there is a question there regarding the fact that the Xhosa wars of resistance are not well publicized. And I've been asked to comment on the vacuum there regarding the Xhosa land wars. And the person who asked the question is also saying that I should suggest some particular books. The Xhosa land wars were, in fact, some of the longest wars of land resistance on the African continent. I think also there is no other war that Europeans have fought or engaged in on the African continent which has lasted longer than the Xhosa land wars, which lasted a period of a century, a whole 100 years. I mean, just now I said that by the year 2100 is just 77 years away from us. So imagine a period that long engaged in battles, and these wars that were fought by the Xhosas were wars of land dispossession, with African people resisting against, you know, the colonization of their land. And I think without exhausting much on that, part of the reason why I think these Xhosa wars of resistance are not much publicized is because of the concerted effort that the Xhosa people engaged in battle from the kings like King Yintsa, King Makoma, the kings Osahili and others who were engaged in battle. And I think these are inspiring stories and stories that would really uplift the consciousness of African people and inspire African people to see that, you know, our ancestors resisted for such a long period of time before they were defeated. But just going to some of the books maybe that you can read on in relation to these Xhosa land wars. But before I go to the books, what Europeans used to call these wars, which is very interesting, they used to refer to them in the first books that were written about these wars. They were called the Kafir Wars of Resistance. And I think it's important that they used to refer to, and even the number of books that I'm going to give to you, they refer to our people as the Kafirs. So the first book is Campaigning in Kafir Land, or Sins and Adventures in the Kafir War of 1851-52. And it is written by William Ross King. And then you've got another book, which the title is simply The Kafir Wars, 1779 to 1877. And it is written by A.J. Smithers. And then another book is Narrative of the Kafir Wars from 1850, 51 to 52. And it is written by R. Godlonton and Edward Iving. The last book, which I would also suggest we read, is called What I Saw in Kafir Land, The Experiences with the Waterkloof Rangers during the Xhosa War in the Cape Colony. And it is written by Stephen Lakeman. So these are just some of the books that you can go and they elaborate more as, but also some of these books, they look into the social life of the Xhosa people and what enabled them to actually resist this long, what elements in their culture enabled them to resist for this long. The second question, which I think was directed to me by my sister, is, well, perhaps it's directed to myself and Mwalimu, it's how can we reimagine a new Africa? And how can we use all of this knowledge in ways that are more attractive or appealing to our people? And I think what my sister is speaking to there, firstly, for me, is the fact that African people have been so desensitized of our experience, such that we are no longer emotionally connected to the experiences of our ancestors. So even as we speak about these histories of resistance and this and that, when we just merely speak it, our people cannot really comprehend or connect with what we are saying. And I think when we were at the Black House Collective, we developed something which we referred to as a shock therapy, you know, because we believe that Black people need to be awakened out of this sleep and this slumber, you know, and we need to use forms and means that are creative, you know, or innovative in order to tap into, you know, the sleeping mind, you know, of the Black man and the Black woman. And what we called shock therapy, we developed an exhibition, basically, an exhibition that we would just take into the public areas in Black communities and start teaching Black people. We display not only the traumatic experiences of slavery, the lynchings that we went through, at home and abroad, because lynchings also occurred here in places like Zimbabwe under the so-called Rhodesian regime. They lynched our people in Mozambique, the Portuguese lynched our people. And there are images that are there in the archives which we have made concerted efforts to go and dig out those images that show some of those atrocities, images that are hidden that would never be shown in school or in TV or in the media. And we use some of those as a way of making the Black man and the Black woman emotionally connected to the pain of that history, emotionally connected to our ancestors. So shock therapy, I would say, is one of the ways which we must use, but also not only showing the tragic experiences or, you know, the degrading of Black people, but also display images of Black civilizations. Some of these civilizations we spoke about, some of these great achievements that Black people achieved, and display them visually using images. And I think that, you know, when we use, they usually say a picture tells 1,000 words. And so when you use these images, these visuals, they have so much impact, and they have a transformative, they have a transformative effect on the ones that see them. And so I think that's just simply one of the ways which I would say we could address this. And then there was a question there. The second question is around the issue of accountability on what really happened and the points of our failures that we can learn from our past. I think it was Amilcar Cabral, if I'm not mistaken, who spoke about the cancer of betrayal in the African continent. And throughout our histories, we have this experience of betrayal within our, you know, own family. I mean, I don't need to mention the number of betrayals that African people have experienced during those slave rebellions that I mentioned. A number of them were actually subverted and sabotaged by other slaves who gave out information to the slave master. During the colonial era, you have a number of traitors who betrayed their own brothers and sisters in service of a white terror domination, in service of the colonialist. And so I think that this is one area which we need to really, really, really look at. This, I guess if I were to use the Abrahamic term, this Judas mentality that we have of betraying our very own and betraying ourselves, you know, and I think that's one critical area which perhaps at some point, at some stage in time, we would need to look at it. Uti, how do we resolve this issue of betrayal? You know, because I mean, someone can be taught as much theory, teach them so much values and this and that, but at one point or another, the very same people who betray us are the people that we trust the most. I mean, Kwame Nkrumah was betrayed by people he trusted the most, his most trusted generals in Ghana. You know, Thomas Sankara is betrayed by Blaise Compaoré, you know, his best friend, his most trusted friend next to him, and so forth. And the story goes on. Even Amilcar Cabral himself, while he spoke about the cancer of betrayal, he himself was betrayed and assassinated by his very own people. And so we need to really deal with this aspect. I mean, today, currently, we are in the year 2023, we are under a so-called democracy in this country. And yet, those who are in leadership and in power, in charge of the state here in South Africa, for example, they are the very same people who have betrayed the cause of the millions of Black people who are in this country. So the cancer of betrayal continues to persist until this day. The reason why we do not own our minerals and our industries and whatnot is simply because we have people who will betray us, you know, for a little crumbs of bread. And I think I will end there and allow Mwalimu to also come in.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mwalimu Tando. Mwalimu Nehusi.
Thank you very much for the questions. The first one I want to address is the question of pathways toward youth. This is not the terminology of the sister who asked the question, but I think what I got from it is, how do we get our young people involved? And there is no one answer. Things would vary, but I think one thing we could do is recognize that we have to go where people are. We have to not only physically meet them where they congregate, but we also have to speak to them and articulate the interests of our people in terms and in media that young people understand and wish to engage with. So for this era, for example, I would think that social media is an extremely effective way of communicating. I would think that finding appropriate music, like we were playing Nas at the beginning of the program, is our ability to communicate the ideas in ways that our young people are not only attracted to, but understand easily, that we will result in our victory. Perhaps the crassest way I could put this is, you know, like we attempting, or anybody attempting to speak to somebody else in a language that the person doesn't understand, you wouldn't have effective communication. So our challenge is to speak to our young people in ways that they understand us through media that they prefer to be reached by. Nobody from who is not familiar, intimately familiar with specific circumstances would be able to tell you beyond that how you must approach the young people. And it's important that we understand the variations in the specific existence of our people. The next question is basically, do we recreate or attempt to recreate pre-colonial Africa? Or do we try to build a new Africa that is still distinctly African? Well, it's the latter. You cannot recreate the past in that exact way anyhow. And if we study pre-colonial Africa, one of the things that maybe we didn't say is that it was always in a state of evolution. You know, things didn't remain the same. People improved on how to do this, how to do that. They changed when they went to a different physical environment because something wasn't available, and so on and so forth. These are the ways, excuse me, in which variations occur. But African people maintained the identical ideas and very often the same or distinctly similar ways of living those ideas. And it is our challenge to rediscover our past, retake our past, and begin to relive those that legacy of our ancestors in terms of rituals, in terms of social organization, and so on and so forth. So I would say that is our challenge, and we shouldn't be afraid of making innovations whenever that is necessary, because that's the stuff of progress. Our ancestors made innovations from what they received from their ancestors, and so on and so forth. So that's one of the lessons. The last thing I have here is the question of spirituality and religion. Our brother was asking, well, why is that left out of the list? The short answer is it wasn't. Spirituality is part of African culture. You cannot have an African, real African culture without spirituality. It pervades the entire culture of African people. And let me just say here that African people did not have religion. African people did not have religion. Religion is a set of rules with one or two, but certainly a small circle of people in control, telling you what to do and how to do it and what not to do. African people didn't have that. We had something that was far more deep, wide, and profound. It was with us in everything we did, and that's spirituality. So although I didn't mention the word spirituality, my good brother, it was implied in what I said. And I do welcome your focus upon it so that nobody could escape the point that that's part of African culture and an indispensable part also. How would I hear?
Thank you so much. I think we have come to the end of today's session. I won't take more questions from here. We have our WhatsApp group for those who have registered there. The question will continue to be posed there. And also it's good that sometimes we just leave the discussion when people are still seeking more so that they can start with their journey and go and look for more information that is beneficial to them. I would just want to add a few things that from Brother Tando, one of the things that he was talking about the civilization that started here in Azania, and he's talking about the place in Mpumalanga, in Zalo Yelanga. This is one of the places that I will just always encourage people when you are around Azania, please make time to go and see that place. It is important that we start to travel our own continent so that we should be able to connect with it and understand the knowledge that is out there. Also, on the issue of we must build power, and the power that we must build, it's also mental power and spiritual power and physical power. We need to get our mind in good shape. How are we thinking? What are we thinking about? In which way we are thinking that we are coming up with new ways? And our spiritual power, like Prof. Nehusi has just reiterated that issue. Without going back into understanding our spirituality, the cosmology, the understanding of the guidance that we always have as African people, will always be confused of how we even use our spirituality to renew ourselves. And also the physical power, we have to take care of ourselves, our body. We have to take care of this body that is holding this incredible spirit that it needs us to work. And for that, we also need to have a healthy body to do that. And we should not be scared to come up with new innovation. It's the same innovation that our ancestors have always had. That is why they resisted and we are still resisting. So thank you so much again, everyone. Thank you so much for tonight's session. This the first session of our master class for this season, which is the season 4. We will continue with other sessions that are coming. Keep on making sure that you tune in and send information to other people, your friends, your family, those that you know that they will also benefit from there. We will close up, we come now to the end of our session, and good night and good morning to those that it's morning to them. Thank you.
Harambe.
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 Come on.
More fire.
Yes, I.
Shalom. Shalom.
Harambe.
Harambe.
Morning to you. Give thanks for the move. That's respect, man. A possible solution. Big up to yourself. Big up to Ebu Kosini Solutions, you know? Respect.
Big up, big up.
Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Is the day we working? Can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Is the day we working? Can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now.
The black oasis, ancient Africa, the sacred awaken, the sleeping giant. Science, art is your creation. I dreamt that we could visit old Kemet. Your history is too complex and rigid for some Western critics. They want the whole subject diminished, but Africa's the origin of all the world's religions. We praise bridges that carried us over the battlefronts of Sudanic soldiers, the task put before us.
You hear me out, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. This the day we workings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. This the day we workings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today?
Who are we today? The slums, diseases, AIDS, we need that all to fade. We cannot be afraid. So who are we today? We are the morning after, the makeshift youth, the slave ship captured. Our diaspora is the final chapter, the ancestral lineage built pyramids. America's first immigrant, the king's son and daughters from now waters. The first architect, the first philosophers, astronomers, the first prophets and the doctors was us.
Hey, now can we all pray, each in his own way, teaching and learning. We can work it out. We'll have a warm bed, we'll have some warm bread and shelter from the storm dread. And we can work it out. Mother Nature feeds all in famine and drought. Tell those selfish in ways not to share us out. What's a tree without root? Lion without tooth? Lie without truth, you hear me out. Africa must wake up, your sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. They start every working. Can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, Lord. Well, Africa must wake up, your sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may some more love come. Yesterday we were kings. I tell you, young blood, this world is yours today.
Daddy, oh, daddy, why, yeah, never the D-E-D-E. On ninky torte pizza, why didn't get D-E-D-E. On the marquilla deso, why didn't get D-U-N-S-E. On the hot ninky dumb eye, why didn't get D-O-H-E. Daddy, oh, daddy, why, yeah, never the D-E-D-E. On ninky torte pizza, why didn't get D-E-D-E. On the marquilla deso, why didn't get D-U-N-S-E. On the hot ninky dumb eye, why didn't get D-O-H-E.
From where you live, how near, how far, Africa, China, Japan.